making all whole units. Fire at will.
Squad 2, pick a target.
Too many, Captain.
Watch your stabilizer, Gold 6. Anybody coming?
No. 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 Yes.
Some moments echo throughout the galaxy.
Execute Order 66.
But this is the journey of an unlikely few. Meet the Bad Batch.
You ready for this?
Hunter, the leader.
In and out, quickly and quietly.
Wrecker, the brawler.
I'm missing all the action!
Tech, the specialist.
This is not a standard military operation.
Echo, the hacker.
This great plan of yours is looking really lousy about now.
And Crosshair, the marksman.
Go away.
Altered by genetic mutations, a ragtag band of clones struggles for survival.
Knife!
And their choices will determine their fate in a dangerous new galaxy.
Welcome to episode 64 of Radio Free Endor, the Bad Batch Report, where we catch up week by week with Clone Force 99 and their escape from the newly formed Galactic Empire. I'm Jamie, your host, and with me is my son, Christopher. How you doing, Chris?
Hi, I'm really good, thanks.
What have you been up to?
Recently, I started reading the Star Wars comics on Marvel Unlimited. It's not necessarily got the latest comics on, i.e. the ones from 2 months ago, but it's got all of the ones on it since 2017. So if you don't mind not having the latest ones on it, it's actually a really good read. And it's only £8.99 a month or $8.99. And for me, who's never read any of the comics, I'm finding it really interesting. There's a lot of dark content in the comics.
Yeah, there was. I'm more familiar with the Dark Horse Star Wars comics. They are basically what was out there before Disney took over it, of course, and then pulled it back. I've not read any of the Darth Vader ones, any of the New Republic ones, or any ones of Rebels, basically. Is that what you're catching up on?
Yeah, I've read the first two comics of High Republic. There's two comic series of Darth Vader. There's Darth Vader's 2017. That is about soon as he becomes Darth Vader. So obviously, the start of the Empire and him in the suit. I'm reading that one right now. And I've recently got up to date on Darth Vader 2019. That's actually, it starts exactly after Return of the Jedi. Not Return of the Jedi, Empire Strikes Back, when Luke has his scene with Darth Vader, and Darth Vader says, "I am your father." And I actually really recommend reading this comic series, because to put simply, without saying the storyline too much, because it's actually, some of the things that are in it is actually really interesting, is that as soon as Darth Vader obviously leaves Cloud City, he basically... Yeah. goes on this quest to find out who hid Luke from him. Who were the people that hid Luke from him? So he goes to Naboo. He goes to Tatooine. He goes to the place where she gave birth to the twins. Mustafar.
That's like an asteroid, isn't it?
Mustafar. He literally goes to all these different planets. Oh my gosh. Is worth reading. If you do anything before the next episode, read the Darth Vader comic of 2019, because I don't know how much spoilers you want, but there's some real, really good things in there. And some things that are kind of interesting. Yeah.
Hmm. If I remember rightly, has it got a design where you see Vader looking at the gravestone of Padme?
Not only that, he opens her grave.
Ooh. I take it once that necklace back.
Wow.
You don't deserve this.
Wow. No, not just that. Wow. Does he open her grave? That is a contentious question. One of the questions it asks. Because, yes, he does visit her grave. He visits Naboo. He visits all of these places. For example, what do you think happened to Naboo after the Empire? Well, this comic tells you. This comic tells you. And I could tell you.
Yeah, go on, please.
It's spoilers. They become Armadalians, they call themselves. A rebel unit called the Armadalians. And their whole purpose is to find the assassin, the murderer, who killed Anakin Skywalker and Princess Amidala. That's their whole point. And it's got Shmeed. Shmeed is her name, I think. Princess Amidala's bodyguard in. It's got characters from episode one in. It's got loads of, like seriously, without giving away too much, because there's a lot of stuff in there.
Yeah.
It's really worth reading.
I'll have to check that out myself. I've not read it. That's what I mean.
I've only said stuff that's happened up to the third comic, and I think there's 12. I can tell you something that happens in the latest comic is that he finds Exegol, but that's not what I've read yet.
Yeah, that's in Darth Vader issue 11. Yeah, it's pissed a lot of people off that comic has so far, because basically the comics at the moment are trying to fill in to make the sequel trilogy work, make it
not necessarily sort of like, because how it comes about is not as you'd expect it to come about. Is what I'm saying. Because, you know, I've not obviously read where I've read up to, obviously spoilers, but obviously I'm not going to tell too much how it happens, but Darth Vader finds the Pathfinder to Exegol, the one that is in the Death Star, supposedly. I'm putting the connection as it is the same one. But how does he come about it? Who tells him about it? Who can he trust? You know, did the Empire even tell him about Exegol?
Yeah.
You know, well, these are all questions that the comics will tell you. And you can read up to episode 10 in it on this Marvel Unlimited app. It's an iPad app or an iPhone app. Or I'm pretty sure it's on Android as well. I've read up to episode 10, and that was obviously published February 2021. So I'm just I'm going to wait until the next ones come out. Maybe I might buy them. But yeah, the Darth Vader comic, wow, is all I say. Mm. Wow, it totally had some interesting things. And I also read the Lando comic, the five comic Lando comic. Have you ever read that?
No, I've not. I've not read any of these comics.
Well, this comic is got a story about about Lando and Lobot, and why Lobot's like how Lobot is in The Empire Strikes Back, why he is like that, and that's also a good comic series worth reading. That's definitely worth reading. And the thing is, it has got all the classic stuff on this Marvel Unlimited app as well. Of all the pre-canon stuff, well, the legacy stuff now. Definitely worth reading. If there's one thing I can say is read the Lando comic and then read the Darth Vader comics, because they're so, so good and they say a lot.
Yeah, I will do. I'll have a look into them. Definitely look into them. Yeah, was it five parts, did you say, of the Lando comics?
Yeah. The Lando is just five parts. My next one to read is I'm going to read Kanan, and then I'm going to read the Darth Maul ones. The Darth Maul ones also came out in 2017.
That's cool, that's really, really cool. Me, I have done nothing, basically. I've just watched... funny enough, I started watching some of the original Star Wars films on Disney+. I put on A New Hope because... I have actually done something. Remember me saying a couple of weeks ago that I was doing a short story for Pod Life 2 for Rob Southgate on the Southgate Media Group for a book? Well, it was, I had to do it 1,800 words. I did it in 1,801 one word. And I was thinking, damn. What word can I take out? And I couldn't make up my mind. I just couldn't do it. I couldn't take out one word. So I forwarded it to Rob, and Rob's had a look at it. So hopefully he'll be able to take out one word to make it fit. But I do go into the fact that, you know, my mum took me to see Star Wars back, originally. And how my fandom has grown through time, especially with the films that have come on and stuff like that. It was a really interesting time, actually, to sort of go back and think about it and write it all down in sort of like a book form. So hopefully it'll be in it, and then I can put down, I suppose, on my bio that I'm an author as well. That's pretty cool, isn't it?
Yeah, that is really cool. I've just sent you one screenshot. It's technically piracy, what I've just done. But I sent you one screenshot from the comic. It doesn't say too much about the comic, but it will intrigue you.
Is this from the new image? It's from the new
episode, this is from the new comic. Darth Vader 2019.
Picture. Well, basically, for everyone who's listening to us on audio, the picture that he sent me, it's... how can I describe it, really? It's Darth Vader looking down the shaft of Cloud City where Luke fell. But he's looking down, and then he sees himself as Vader falling. Then he sees himself as Anakin falling as a Padawan Anakin. Then he sees himself as the 10-year-old Anakin falling. So going down. It makes me want to read it now. Think about it now. Tell me about this app now, Chris, because you said if you sign up to it you get like is it like a trial period?
Yeah, it's free? Like an eight is a, I think it's a 7-day free trial. It is backed by Apple's subscription, so if you forget to cancel it, you will be charged. But it's literally on the App Store. It's called Marvel Unlimited. It should be available in America, England, and basically, yeah. You literally just sign up for it, search the comics you want. It is a bit of a fiddly app. The user interface is not very intuitive, but the Star Wars comics are on there. You just got to find them is the hard part. It has got more than just Star Wars on there. You know, it's got USA agent. So it says new this week is Captain Marvel, US Agent number 3, The Union, Black Cat. So it's got all your Marvel comics on there as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's got your Star Wars on there. It's got your Marvel on there. While, as I said, comics do come out every month. There is like a delay. It very much seems like, and I don't know how long it is, but there's like a 3-month delay until they put the comic free on the app.
Yeah.
Because obviously you can pay... I think on another one of their apps, you can pay £4 each comic and you own the comic digitally. But this app is kind of like more of a Netflix kind of thing.
Yeah.
But obviously, you've got the backlog, the delay, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's true. Right, what we'll do now, Chris, we'll head over to some news from the Star Wars world, and we'll also be talking about some stuff that's going on with Disney themselves. Yeah. Shall we head over?
Yeah.
Cool. Let's head over to the news.
You've taken your first step into a larger world.
Now, On the news, I'll tell you what, Chris, there's one thing that me and you do love. It's Lego. We do like our bits of Star Wars Lego and stuff. And funny enough, I've just picked up, managed to pick up, finally, the big Ecto-1 Master Build Ecto-1 for £140 from Costco. Now, I think, Chris, isn't the Ecto-1, I know it's Ghostbusters this is, but isn't the Ecto-1 like £170 from the Lego shop? But the reason I managed to pick it up for so cheap is because you, Chris, sent me a message saying that you'd walked through Costco and you actually saw a deal that was on that gave you something like, 20% or something, but it was only for a limited time. So, you know, because with Costco, when you go into Costco in the UK, I don't know what it's like in the States, but when you go into the Costco in the UK, the price you see is not the actual price you pay because you've got to add on the VAT. Now, when we added on the VAT, that it came to £140.
That is United States for you. Everything is minus sales tax in the United States.
Oh, yeah, it did. Yeah, just reminded me. It really pissed me off that did when we were in the States. I was thinking, why didn't you just put the price with the VAT on? Because your shop is not moving, is it? The shop's not just going to get up and leg it.
They're currently selling it for £137 on Amazon.
Are they?
Yeah.
Ah,
it's discounted. It's discounted though from the RRP retail suggested price of retail recommended price of 179. The reason we went to Costco was actually for a baby Yoda squishy mellow pillow, I think they're called.
Yeah,
and we walked out with a Chewy one instead because they had no Grogu ones.
Really?
Yep.
Baby Grogu then is selling out fast, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, like literally there was so the marshmallow pillows, I think they're called, there was R2-D2,
yeah,
BB-8, Chewy, yeah, and Grogu, I think.
Oh, right.
Was all of them. Oh my god. People are reselling them on eBay for $100.
Really?
Yeah, I picked it up £20. Wow.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Yeah. So Chris is just holding up a picture to me, and it's like a little squishy thing with a picture of him on it.
They're not small, though.
Is it like a pillow? Is that what you're showing me? Pillow? This is all very interesting, isn't it, for people who are listening on audio. Yeah, Chris has just legged it off now to get me to show me this pillow. Because I've not seen it, but it does look very cute. And we all do love Baby Yoda or Baby Grogu. But it's a sweet, sweet Baby Yoda. Yodel. Yodel? Sweet, sweet baby. Oh, there he is. Oh, my God. Oh, it's like... it's not like a pillar at all. It's more like a massive beanbag.
And
he's got the... he's got Chewy. That's awesome. I love it. Take a photo of that, Chris, and we'll put it on our Facebook page, yeah? That looks awesome. I love it.
They're selling it on eBay, $100. But they're obviously available in Costco right now. So if you've got a Costco around you, take a look. You might find it.
Yeah, yeah. And also, do you know, I've been looking at, talking about going back to the Lego. Do you know that Razor Quest that you bought, Chris?
Mm-hmm.
Right? That is on the Lego store for £120, that Laser Quest, Razor Quest. But now, you bought it way cheaper than that, didn't you?
I think I bought it for £95.
That's pretty cheap. Now, I'm actually looking on the actual official Lego set. Now, Lego channel. Now, they've got a couple of fantastic Lego sets, which I'd love to get my hands on. One of them is £319, and it's the Mos Eisley Canteen. Looks incredible.
The thing is, you say that, there's a lot of Lego sets that just don't do it for me. Like, the Millennium Falcon's one of them. Like, I think it's cool. I've seen yours. It just doesn't do it for me. Like, it's just not a Lego set I want to own. And I don't know why. Like, the Mos Eisley, it's not a set I'd like to own either. Maybe it's because it's all the original stuff, and as I've said before, I'm profoundly less of an original fan than... You know, it's not my favourite trilogy.
Yeah, well, it's understandable, isn't it? And also, that Lego are bringing out these weird helmets. These helmets you build out of Lego. Now, there's a magazine that you can buy at the moment with miniature little helmets. People, I don't know what's happening with them, because people are selling them on eBay and on Facebook Marketplace for real cheap. And to tell you the truth, they look cheap. They look really cheap, these helmets. Because they're really small. They're only like, what, an inch big? 2 inches, maybe? Really, really small. But Lego have done their own brand of the helmets. They've got a Darth Vader. They've got a Scout Trooper. And I think they've got a Boba. But there was one set that really jumped out at me, and I've seen it at Smith's Toys, and that's the Imperial Probe Droid. It's quite a big one. It looks really nice. I'm quite partial to the Imperial Probe Droid, because they did bring it out as an action figure, but I never seen it, never managed to get hold of it. And now they've also got the Bad Batch Shuttle, which is £89 on their official website. Now, the reason I was talking about Lego, Chris, more than anything, is that thanks to China, they have released a couple of images for some Lego sets that are just not out yet. Yeah, and one of them is this year's Christmas Advent calendar. Now, I'm a sucker for these Advent calendars, and I must admit, I missed last year's Christmas just gone. When it's in the shop, I always think, oh, I'll buy that a bit closer to Christmas. And when I get round to it, they've always sold out. And then people are trying to flog them on eBay for like loads of money. But this one that's on, it's got the Razor Quest in it, right? And what looks like the little figures that you've got, a little Mandalorian with a little baby Grogu. You've also got, what looks, because it's quite a blurry image. You've also got what looks like a sand person pushing a sledge with a gun on it. You've got a stormtrooper with a turbo cannon. You've also got what looks like a speeder bike. And you've also got like a probe. And then flying around, I can see an X-Wing, a TIE fighter. But there's actually Moff Gideon's cruiser is on that as well.
Yeah, I've just noticed there's three new Lego sets on Lego.com that I've not noticed. All three of them are coming out August the 1st, and that's the Mandalorian Starfighter. Obviously, this is a re-release set, because this has been out before, but now it also has Boba Fett, a Darth Maul Mandalorian, and also Bo-Katan. And also Bo-Katan with the helmet or the wig. So, yeah, my favourite Starfighter. This one is 100%. This one's definitely going to be purchased sooner or later.
Wasn't this kit in a different colour last time it came out?
No, it was in that colour.
Was it? And it's the same kit, because I thought that one was slightly bigger than that.
No, I think it's the same kit, to be fair.
Yeah. It looks pretty awesome, though, I must admit.
Then there's also a Jewel on Mandalore figure that has. I don't know if this is actually the first time there is an Ahsoka Lego figure, to be fair.
Yeah.
But there's the Ahsoka Lego figure, there's a Darth Maul Lego figure, there's the Throne of Mandalore, and there's also the Crypt that they hold Darth Maul in as they transport him to Coruscant.
Oh, yeah, the Jewel of Mandalore. That looks pretty cool. That's only $17.99.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Wow, that's really nice and cheap, that. And yeah, it looks like a proper new sculpt, new colours on Darth Maul as well, you know, with his with the prints actually on his legs. Looks pretty cool. And she looks fantastic. That is a really cool set, that one.
So, yeah. Really interesting. And then the third one is the one you will probably like the most, is the Darth Vader's Meditation Chamber.
Oh, man, that looks really cool as well. That's £60. Oh, that looks sweet as a nut. And it closes as well. 663 pieces. I like these new looks. If you see these new boxes that they're doing for these Lego kits, where it's like a black box and the name of the kit is in a real nice sharp font. proper looks adult, like an adult.
What do you
kit.
Say that? Yeah, the black is more adult and the white is more child friendly. What child's going to want Darth Vader's meditation chamber?
Yeah.
Not many.
Yeah, you're right there.
Now, how many adults will want Darth Vader's meditation chamber?
Yeah, I love that Mediterranean, that meditation center. It's very nice. And you're right, kids will just chuck it about, you know, small kids. Hey, that's an adult toy, that is. Now, I've just sent Christopher the pictures of the advent calendar, as well as another set, which is on this Chinese website, which I don't know what the website is, but the pictures are on, which is Moff Gideon's battlecruiser. Didn't you say you like this one, this cruiser?
Yeah, but I'm a bit disappointed. Is it? It looks a bit small.
It does look a bit small, doesn't it?
Yeah, I would have thought they would have done it to the same scale that they've done the Star Destroyer. And if they have done it to the same scale, then kudos. Like, yeah, kudos. You know, look really good. But it does look a bit small. But then it is a smaller vehicle compared to the Star Destroyer. So, yeah.
It's probably to the same scale. Do you know what I mean? How this one is to that one. I like how it's got like a little TIE fighter coming out of it. out the front end of it. It's really, really cool. So it's all really, really good on the Lego front. And I tell you what, that Christmas one, I'm getting that. I'm going to get that advent calendar one. Yeah, so get that. As soon as it's come out, you can bet your bottom dollar it's going to be out at Smith's Toys, Argos, and all the basic retailers. And they always sell out, so definitely go for it.
You know, we've been guessing about the Lego set. And also, there's a news article fully saying everyone that's in every one of the sets.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's on Jedi News. So there's the Jewel of Mandalore. These are the new sets, obviously set to come out in August 2021. We've already covered Jewel of Mandalore. There's the Trexler Medora. So that is with Grief Khan, a mortar stormtrooper, and two stormtroopers. Then there's Slave One. That's with Boba Fett in The Mandalorian and Din Djarin. Then there's the Bad Batch Attack Shuttle, obviously with Hunter, Wrecker, Tech, Echo, Crosshair, and Gronk the droid. There's Moff Gideon's Light Cruiser with Grogu, Din, Cara Dune, Fennec Shand, Moff Gideon, and the Dark Trooper.
Oh, cool. Dark Trooper.
And there's a Mandalorian Starfighter with Gossaxon, Bo-Katan Krizzler, and a Mandalorian Loyalist. So obviously, all of them sets were sort of things that we've been guessing, but due to JediNews.com, they have the full page with it all on and everything that is coming. I can't wait for these sets because August the 1st is right between my birthday and Holly's birthday. So while I've asked for the Bad Batch Attack Show, I may have to actually swap it out now for the Mandalorian Starfighter, because that is... But they're both really cool. But I won't be getting them for my birthday, because my birthday is actually in July. So might have to get them back ordered, for sure.
Yeah, that looks pretty cool. Yeah, definitely. You've also just sent me a picture of some new Galaxy Edge pins, which is the Bad Batch. Bad Batch pin.
Yeah, I don't know how new this is or if it's even a big deal, but I actually saw it on Facebook and it's a pin. So it's supposed to be a limited edition pin that has Echo, Wrecker, Tech, and then below it, on a separate pin that joins together, it has Crosshair. Is that a spoiler? Is it not? Maybe so.
Yeah.
It is just a pin.
Could be. You see, these toy firms and makers of merchandise, they often spoil stuff. Well, because they get to know stuff, don't they? Way before anybody else.
Yeah.
And also, talking about Disney, I managed to catch... We're going off topic here of Star Wars, so skip this bit if you need to. Now, at Disney World, is it the California, Anaheim...
California Adventure, the second gate for the original Disneyland.
Yeah, well, they've just revealed the new Avengers campus. which looks amazing. I watched it live on YouTube. That, you know, they went, oh, you know, I'm glad you could all be here, but it looked like there was not that many people there. They were doing it like a virtual thing with audience. But they had a real Quinjet there. They had Paul Rudd looking as young as ever, the Ant-Man himself. They had Jon Favreau there, and they also had Anthony Mackie was there. And what got me was with it was that, they said, right, they went Avengers Assembled, and they brought out all the Avengers, yeah? And they all stood there waving from the campus. And you had Captain America there, waving, yeah. Then Anthony Mackie, he says, and I'd like to welcome Captain America. And then, of course, it was his version of Captain America, the Falcon Captain America comes in and starts waving. He gives him the shield. And me and my Nikki was like, oh, look, Captain America up near the Quinjet. He's suddenly gone. I thought I was Captain America. I'll just go home then.
Yeah, there's some incredible things at that resort. There's obviously the new Spider-Man animatronic.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Now, this was amazing.
Yeah, it's not. People thought it would be in the ride, but in all essence, to put an animatronic in the ride that could flee, like, that could, like, swing and then do gymnastics in the air and land, that would be pretty hard in a ride to do it, like, every, 30 seconds? So it's outside on the campus, outside the ride.
Top of the building, isn't it? Top of the building.
Yeah, it is.
And it's so
really cool.
It is really cool. Now, the whole sequence has got pre-audio recorded from Tom Holland as Spider-Man. And, of course, you've got your actor doing all the bits. He's rehearsed it. And then he goes, right then, Mr. Stark, I'm going to test this new suit. And then you see him do what looks like a 40-foot jump across. Really, really swings across and lands. And he does his pose in mid-flight. Now, Chris, early last year, maybe 2019, there was footage of an animatronic doll, you could say, mannequin, being put through its paces, being chucked in it when it was doing rolls and doing stuff and landing. And everyone was thinking, what's Disney doing? No one even thought that was going to be for this.
I feel like it's the same kind of thing that kicked it all off with Walt back, you know, all those years ago. The thing of saying, I want to build something extraordinary. I want people to walk in and go, oh my goodness, where did that come from?
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. But in fact, it is. It's Spider-Man.
Most people thought it was going to be for a ride, the Spider-Man ride. But actually, it's for the attraction event outside of the Spider-Man ride.
I never heard of it being for the Spider-Man ride. I never seen, you know, on the videos that I've seen, no one ever mentioned, and I'm talking back then, not the ones that are now showing up. Back then, it was going to be for the Spider-Man ride. But I might be wrong, but my God, what a feat of engineering that is to do that. And if you go on TikTok right now, people are posting left, right and centre going, bloody hell, look at this, it's Spider-Man. And to be fair, it's breathtaking. It is breathtaking.
It's time for a little Spidey exercise. Hey everyone, it's good to see you. Hi, welcome to Avengers Campus. Watch this. Whoa, I can see a roller coaster from here. Cool. Hey, what's going on, guys? Oh, me? Well, you know, just spider stuff. Hey down there, you guys look like hands. Do I look like a spider? Time for some field testing. Hey, could you record it for me? Tag me later.
goodness for those crates and nails. Hey, Sharon, let's do an altitude test with the new improvements.
Great, Spider-Man.
Don't forget to tag me on your video. Hashtag Amazing Spider-Man.
Logging altitude test number 135.
I think you might be rounding up.
Based on previous tests, predicted rate of success, 14%.
Now you're rounding down, right? Okay, it's time to see what this suit can do. I hope it can do this. Here goes something. Okay, no pressure, but there are a lot of people watching. Clear the runway. Spider-Man is clear for takeoff. Oh, wow! Oh, no. This might hurt. I'm okay. The roof broke my fall. And some bones, maybe.
Okay, that stung a bit.
Whoo! Sharon, did you get that?
I got the data.
Kinda killed my vibe there. Hey, wait up! I'm just gonna jump down and meet you.
How good is that? That's just amazing. And it's by got the score, the awesome score by Michael Giacchino. Wow, just fantastic. And do you know what, Chris? I really do hope they bring this to, like, Euro Disney, maybe?
It's already being built. It's halfway through being built. So the campus at Disneyland Paris will have a rethemed rock and roller coaster to Iron Man. We'll have the Web Slinger attraction, the Spider-Man attraction. And I think it also has a walkthrough attraction and shops and restaurants, obviously. The Paris one will actually be better than the Californian one because it's got the rock and roller coaster rethemed to Iron Man when the only ride in California Adventure is... there's two technically. There's the Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout, the old Terror, and then there's also Spider-Man. The Spider-Man ride's interesting, of course, for many reasons, not to go into, because obviously we're not a Disneyland ride podcast, but it very much takes the arcade style of a ride to the next level. Yeah.
Yeah, because you've got like 3D glasses, haven't you?
Yeah, and you shoot with your hands.
Yeah, it must read your hand movements. You know what I mean? Did you not tell me, was it you that told me that you can buy extras to sort of like pay to win on this game, on this ride?
Well, it's not necessarily pay to win because you can't lose the ride. It's extra powers. There is one thing that I do want to tell you. So please don't get too upset. I've already told you I'm planning to go back to Disney World like you are. You're going to go before me. But me and Holly have nailed down a date. May the 3rd till May the 17th. Why would we travel on May the 3rd? Well, isn't that an obvious one? For the exclusive merchandise, of course.
Christopher will be buying me.
Well, I bought you the exclusive merchandise for opening of Batu.
Yeah, you did, yeah. Funny enough, I was just looking at it here. Because I was going through some old patches. And it's one of the patches that I've that I've put in there, and it's a Galaxy's Edge Landing 2019 Black Spire Outpost, and it looks mint. And I want to get a baseball cap to put it on, because when you get patches, it's like, oh, what do I put it on? What do I put it on? Because I haven't got a jacket or anything to put it on, and I want it to look nice, you know what I mean? So I might get a blank baseball cap and put it on. But yeah, absolutely. The merchandise on May the 4th will be out this world, you could say. Especially next year.
There's a lot of people that, you know, all bring their lightsabers and lift up their lightsaber. I saw that this year, and it would be very... If we get to go on them dates, it'll be mega. We're looking it up now to book. So we'll see. I'll come back to you to see if we actually booked it.
Great. And funny enough, on the talk about the booking side, we are all fully paid up now. We are booked. We are booked, paid for. The holiday is now in the hands of the gods to be put on the green list. Because Florida is not on the green list at the moment for the UK. So if we go, we've got to self-isolate for 10 bloody days, which is stupid. Because we're all vaccinated that are going, well, I think we'll all be vaccinated by then, but I know me and Nikki definitely are. So, and I've heard that the mask policy at the theme parks now, Chris, are starting to relax, especially at Universal and Disney. So I think at the Disney, at the moment, you can wear the masks. You don't have to wear a mask outside the park, as in, well, outside the shops, basically. You can walk around without a mask. But if you're going to go in and shop, you've got to put on a mask. Now, I just hope that it all goes to plan. Your brother, Chris, Sam, he's all paid up now. All the kids are paid up. We've just got to buy our tickets now for our theme parks. And I think they're going to be like £1,000. It's very expensive. Who said that going to Florida is a cheap thing? It ain't.
Yeah, well, me and Holly are looking to stay on site and eye-watering amounts. But, you know, you do what you want to do. After the years we've had, you may want to splash out on a nice holiday.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I hope it's all the best for you. Because I know you was tickling with the idea of going on the Disney cruise ship. The Wish.
Yeah, and we was. And it would turn a £4,000 holiday into a £6,000 holiday.
Bloody hell.
So,
that's a lot of money.
Yeah, So we could do four grand, hopefully. But £6,000? Probably not.
Yeah. Just hope that Holly's up to driving over there.
Won't need to, hopefully. If we stay on site, we'll be in the Disney bubble, as they say.
Yeah. Disney bubble. Right.
Spending the
cash. We should leave the news there, Chris, because we're running quite long now with this one. Just going on about the news. And shall we head over to the Bad Batch report and get this episode in the can, shall we say?
Of course. Let's get dispatched.
This is the Bad Batch Report, and we are talking about Season 1, Episode 6, Decommissioned. Sid hires the Bad Batch to retrieve a Separatist tactical droid for its battle intel before it is destroyed at a Corellian decommissioning site. They encounter police droids guarding the facility, as well as Trace and Rafa Martez, who are also after the droid. Wrecker accidentally hits his head and his inhibitor chip begins to activate. Tech and the sisters program the tactical droid to turn on the police droids, allowing them to escape, but the tactical droid is destroyed in the process. The sisters explain that they were retrieving it for a client who is fighting the Empire. Hunter gives them a copy of the droid's data that Tech made during the fight, and the sisters later tell their client how to find the Bad Batch. Ooh. What did you reckon to this episode, Chris?
I thought it was a great episode, to be fair. I'm not a Martez hater. I know a lot of people out there are. I didn't mind them. To me, when they were originally in the in the Clone Wars. It was an arc not about them, but about Ahsoka adjusting to civilian life, right? That was the point of that season and that episode. So, yeah, seeing them in here, yeah, I really enjoyed it, actually. I really enjoyed seeing them and them having a bigger role to play. When I say a bigger role to play, in the Clone Wars, you know, they were just normal people, and then they did a job, right, that went dark very fast, you know? They only cared about themselves. They didn't care about anyone else. They just cared about each other. And Ahsoka seemed to have changed that, because now they seem to be helping people fight the Empire, supposedly.
Now, they are featured in the, I would say, the weakest episodes of the final season of the Clone Wars, and a lot of people said, oh, that's the weakest one. But yeah, you're right. They are there in to forward the story. Ahsoka. Yeah, most definitely. So when they turned up in this one, I was thinking, ah, that seems quite strange. What are they here for? Why are they here on Corellia doing a job? So I thought that's what their deal was droids. So that, I suppose, in one respect, that's where they would get their droids from. Didn't mind them in this episode at all. I enjoyed this episode. Like, from the beginning, where you see Omega trying out her laser bow.
Steady. Arms level. And keep your eye on the target.
You can do it, kid!
Not a chance! Miss! Come on, miss! Got it!
Good. Again.
But I've already hit the target 3 times.
Out of 12. That's luck, Omega. Not skill. So I'll just need to be consistent.
Okay, double or nothing, she chokes.
I was doing better until those two showed up.
You have to learn to tune out distractions, which comes with practice. Again.
And she makes some good shots. Me, I was thinking, why is she shooting an arcade machine? Those things are quite precious. No, don't shoot. And Sid's okay with it. Sid's absolutely okay with them shooting up the place. And when she takes the laser bow, and she goes, choo, 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 choo. And she makes some really good shots. So she knows how to handle herself.
She was like, with them noodle arms, you're not going to do anything.
Noodle arms. Yeah, you're right.
I assume you boys know what a tactical droid is? They were the
the operational brains of the Separatist military.
This is my briefing, goggles. Tactical droid intel has tremendous value, which is why you're gonna break into this decommissioning facility on Corellia and retrieve one before they're all destroyed.
We haven't decided if we're gonna work for you or not.
Allow me to decide for you. You're in. I'm talking a mutually beneficial arrangement. You make money, I make money. And I watch your back. With the heat on you, it's the best option you've got.
I guess we're in.
I know you're in. I just told you you're in. And you're releasing too soon because of those weak noodle arms.
Of course, then they get this job to do. Which is, you know, the Bad Batch are going to become sort of like mercenaries, you know, bounty hunters themselves. Because it's what they're good at. That's what they should be doing, because they are work as a team and they can get things done. Now, this tactical droid that they were after, it's such a callback to the original series of the Clone Wars. And for me, when, you know, during the episode when they reactivated them all, and you got those, you got the droids from episode one, the Raja Raja guys. I love them. They are my favourite droids because they're so dumb. And what does that one say as soon as it's activated? Oh, did we win?
Huh? What's happening? I don't know. Did we win?
New command sequence. Your target is factory security personnel.
And then the next one goes, an order's an order.
Order is an order. Yeah.
Orders are orders.
It was such a good episode. Do you know when you saw all those police bots running after them? I was thinking, how many are they? How many are they them in this base? They just kept like pouring in. Now thinking, how are they going to get away from this one? Because it just seemed like there was just so many of them. It's quite interesting that the Empire's got no use for them whatsoever. No use for them. Now thinking, surely the Empire could easily use those battle droids. Because it's sending a droid instead of sending in a human. You know what I mean? You're going to keep your officers alive, you know, your troopers alive, when you can send in the droids, surely.
Yeah, but the thing is, the droids were part of the losing side, you know.
But they weren't, were they?
They weren't. But at the end of the day, you know, droids are droids. You know, if Dave Filoni's writing a series, you're gonna have a few Clone Wars episodes. Rebels had a few, and obviously this harkens back to that instantly with this super commando droid. Yeah, so I thought this episode was really good, and it really hit the nail in the head with Wrecker. He's obviously, his chip's going to activate sooner or later. Will they catch it in time? That's the only question to ask, really. Mm.
That was very chilling to me when he banged his head and he was saying, "A good soldier follows orders," but he didn't do the full sentence. I was thinking, oh please, yeah, oh man, he's the sweetest of the Bad Batch, you know what I mean? He's got like that child's perspective of everything, and he's scared of heights as well. You know, all kids are scared of heights, bless him. And oh, it's going to be heartbreaking to, you know, if something really bad happens to him.
Everyone thinks he's going to be a challenge to deal with, but you know, if it happens, but I'm pretty sure if it happens that someone on the squad is very agile enough to hit him in the head again. Or I don't know. I just think with everything they're setting up, while it might be an interesting twist, I just don't think that will be the twist, because you know they've set up the twist with Crosshair. It's just a matter of time, you know. And this is nothing against the story writing, but you don't want the story writing to be, in my eyes, you don't want the storyline to be, oh, something's gone wrong with one of the crew. Oh, which one? Well, there's currently something wrong with three of them. You know, which one is, you know what I mean? They're all clones, for God's sake. So knowing the difference is already hard. So, yeah, I think, and it's not in a bad way. If they're gonna play a clone that a Bad Batch that has turned it up to 11 and is now inhibited, then yeah, just leave it with Crosshair. Play it out a little with Wrecker, but let the crew catch it, you know, because potentially that's how they could save Crosshair, is catching it with Wrecker.
Yeah. How many? It depends how many episodes they're going to go down. Because how many episodes? We're in episode 6 now, and they reckon there's another 10 episodes. So they're going to have to start reeling it in to get them all changed, and if they're going to go down the route with that. But saying that, you know, Crosshairs wasn't in this episode, so, and he wasn't in the last one either. So I think the next episode we get will be a Crosshairs one again. You know, bringing them slowly, ways tracking them, bringing them slowly together, because you know they can't, each episode can't be just, oh, they go to SIDS, get another job, complete the job, go back to SIDS, get money, you know what I mean? They can't do that every episode, because technically they've just done that for 2 episodes,
but they've not fetched anything important yet.
Well, yeah, didn't they? Not really, actually. They didn't actually get the merchandise for SIDS this time though, did they? Because they gave it away
here.
What's this?
Tech copied the tactical droid's intel to this data rod before it got destroyed.
Why are you giving it to us?
You'll use it for the right reasons.
Huh, maybe you are different.
To be honest, things were clearer when we were just soldiers.
Take it from me. In the end, We all choose sides.
Unless he made two copies, but he actually gave it away. But so we don't know what Sid's gonna do about that when she finds out.
Yeah, and I personally think that's when they depart from Sid. So my final thoughts on this episode was, who did Raph speak to?
Patch him through, R7. We acquired the tactical droid data from Corellia, and we had help. It was a squad of rogue clones, and I know where to find them. Thought you might want to know.
What's your prediction?
I generally think that she was contacting Bail Organa. It looked like Bail Organa with his cloak that goes over his shoulder. It looked like him. Because they're giving you that hint, because when they did the same trick with Bib Fortuna with his fingers, you could tell it was Bib Fortuna, because he's got a particular sense of his fingernails and his fingers are Bib Fortuna. Bail Organa, the way he's dressed. If it's not, then it'd be Saw Gerrera. It could be him.
I think Bail Organa's, but I also think, and I don't want to be that person, but it could be Rex or Ahsoka, you know, obviously. I definitely think it could be them, obviously, in a different costume, in different clothes. But yeah, I think it's really interesting where it will go and where it will lead. Where will the Clone Force go? Because until this point, we've never heard of them. So unless they're going to start retconning them into, you know, the Battle of Endor...
You like Rex? Yeah, Rex. And there's an even a nice little children's book now about Rex and the Battle of Endor. Yeah.
Well, yeah, exactly. You know, they're just going to start doing that. And sure, but something happens to them. What? We don't know.
Do you think, Chris, after this series pans out and maybe a couple of seasons in, saying that they survive, do you think that Disney might go down the live action route with these?
No.
No, you don't think so?
It would take too much money. Well,
how much is each episode of a Star Wars episode costing now? I think each episode of a like The Mandalorian, you could have filmed the entire budget of the original Star Wars film in that.
I 100% think The Bad Batch costs a quarter of every Mandalorian episode. Even though it's computer generated, obviously writing the models is the hardest part, but generating the models is a lot better. But as I said, if they make it live action, what? They're going to pay...
Bradley Baker, do you mean?
Yep. To do 5 characters. He's already got his own TV show.
Technically. The other thing as well about this episode is, did you notice the R2 droid that the sisters used to contact? R7. Now, that is Ahsoka's droid, isn't it?
In a different colour scheme.
Is it?
Yep. In the Ahsoka, he was black and gold. In this, he's white and green, I believe.
Well, I'm just checking now, Chris, and he is actually black and gold. Still black and gold. But do you want to know the dark history of R7?
Mm-hmm.
He was an astrometric droid. With a masculine programming who belonged to Ahsoka. During the Clone Wars, he served as the astrometric socket of various starfighters whenever she flew in combat. R7 remained loyal to Tano after a departure from the Jedi Order. When she found herself on the run from the clone troopers after Order 66, including the capturing clone commander Rex to remove his inhibitor chip, R7 was subsequently destroyed by blaster fire when Tano and Rex was fighting other clones in the hangar after the crash in the Venture class Star Destroyer. So, but Tano and Rex salvaged his remains from the wreckage. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point, they give R7 back.
Wow. Yeah, of course.
Hold on. This is after Order 66. So he was destroyed. Then Rex and Ahsoka rebuilt him, and somewhere between from that point, you know, where they're loading up his, because you actually do see him in the Y-Wing, from that point to the Bad Batch, he gets taken to the sisters. So, possibly, Ahsoka from that last episode of the Clone Wars, in hiding, she then went to the sisters, who are really good with astromech droids, yeah, and they could have rebuilt him
potentially.
yeah. So yeah. So you reckon this episode is definitely a tick or a tock?
It's definitely a tick.
Definitely a tick. I'll have to agree with you. I love this episode. I think it's really, really good. Out of 10, Chris, what would you rate it?
For 20 minutes, I would rate it a 8.
Is that all it was? Just 20 minutes?
Yeah, they're all like 20 minutes. 25 minutes, 24.
Mm.
It's around there.
Yeah. I will go with 8 as well. I'll agree with you on this one on 8. It was really super good. Like I said, didn't mind the sisters being in it. It always seems weird that whenever somebody's doing something, the other team are doing it on the same day at the same time. You know, lastminute.com. Basically, this episode is lastminute.com because that last technical droid is about to be chucked into the molten lava. Mm. Yeah, well, into the molten metal. Terminator 2 style. That's what this episode also reminded me. Proper like Terminator 2, you know, where they're in the steel works.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was good. Did get a thumbs up. A Terminator thumbs up, but it certainly got a Terminator thumbs up from myself for this episode. Great. Any final thoughts on it, Chris? Where it's going to go or what?
I'm interested. And I'm committed. So, yeah, I'm really interested to see where it goes. I look forward to yet another episode of Echo and the rest of them.
Oh, do you know when you just said that? You know when she goes, is there an Echo in here? He went, hello? Yeah, I'm Echo.
We need a diversion.
What we need is a diversion.
Is there an Echo in here?
Yes.
What?
I'm Echo.
Really? Okay, Echo. We need a distraction. And he can help with that.
Exactly.
That was a good joke on that. I like that one. That made me chuckle.
Exactly.
That's good.
The only Echo you need.
He's the only Echo you need. Right then, Chris, that brings us to the end of the show. Right, want to show your love for this show and look ultra cool? Then head over to TeePublic and get your official Radio Free Endor t-shirt, hoodies and masks, also stickers, keyrings, mugs and mouse mats. In fact, anything. They've even done the face masks, but I don't know how long face masks are going to last now. Also, the episode is available on iTunes, so that's the best place to download the show. Also, if you go onto our Facebook page, because we're on social media and Twitter and Instagram, but on Facebook, if you head over there, we link the latest show at the top of our page. So absolutely, go over there, add a comment, spread share, do what you do on social media to spread the word, and definitely comment on what we've been saying and stuff, because it'd be great to read some feedback about these episodes and what you thought about them. Also, while you're on iTunes, maybe leave us a 5-star review, because it's the only way we get more listeners on board. And like I said, you can reach out to us on social media like Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. We do have a Patreon site. I have started to update it a little bit. But I find Patreon really, really hard to get my head around. But if you search on Patreon as Sir Jedi Jamie, that's me, you'd be able to find our page at the moment. I'm going to try and upload our podcasts as they are raw, as me and Chris record them. So you'll get all the bits and bobs that I don't cut out, all the ums and ahs and everything. But at least you get the episodes in full. You can find us on Twitter at Radio Free Endor. And I am at Jamie_R_Burns. Our email is radiofreeendor@gmail.com. Also, I'm the host of Ghostheads UK, which I'll be putting together a new episode of that very, very shortly. Chris, what about you? Where can people find you and see your stuff?
You can follow me on Twitter. It's BurnChris. And I also have a podcast about JavaScript and programming, and that is fsjam.org. or on any podcast player of your choice.
Fantastic. Chris, on your podcast, you talk about game design and stuff like that.
No, I'm not. I'm not a game programmer. I'm a web developer / applications programmer.
Oh, right. So okay.
Game design is not my category, not my physics.
Fantastic. fantastic. Right, so that just leaves me to say goodbye, and I'll see you next time for another episode of the Bad Batch Report. Keep an ear out for us, and like I say, also for that book, Pod Life, which is available on Amazon, and soon Pod Life 2. Chris, you can say bye-byes now.
Thank you, and see you soon.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Got it.
Good.